Hey again, everyone. David here. We're going to carry on with talking a little bit about Solitaire ASL. By request, I'm going to carry on from my last video in which I set up a Solitaire ASL mission. I'm going to talk through the first turn. So let's go over to the map and let's talk through what happens. Here we are again at the map. Now, as a reminder, the suspect counters are set up according to the provisions already laid out. Now, I don't have my full forces here, but I'm just going to illustrate a little bit. So I just have a few leaders and half squads out. I'm just going to talk about what happens, and that's fine. Okay, so we're ready to play. And the first thing I've done is I've set my forces up off board, as I have here. And I'll explain why they're laid out as they are now. The first thing you'll do after this is roll for a win change die roll. Remember that this is also a potential for the random event generator. I'm rolling for myself, so this is for the Germans. I will roll this now. I've rolled the dice, I've rolled a 10, no effect. Remembering that the random event numbers for the Germans are 4 and 5. Had I rolled a simple a 4 or 5, we'd consult the table. That didn't happen, so let's carry on with the rest of the turn. Unlike regular ASL, I cannot simply move all the units I wish to with complete freedom. In Solitaire ASL, there are command and control rules. So if I want to do anything in any phase, on any turn, other than during the rally phase or the route phase, I have to apply the command and control rules. And it's quite simple. If you want to do something, the first thing you do is you can find a nearest, you can either activate the individual unit or more likely, you will start with your best leader, try to activate him, who can then carry on his command rating. How does this work? Basically, every unit has as its command rating the morale level. So over here from left to right, the command ratings are 10, 10, 7, and 8. For single man counters and for crews, the DRM on the two dice you roll to see if it's if they remain in command, it is simply a negative 1 DRM. For half squads, full squads, etc., you just simply roll their morale level. Berserk units, those guys, they're exempt this stuff. The guys in human ways, etc. Anyway, so let's roll for the command rating and then apply the results. I start with the best leader, and in this case, I rolled a 9. Minus 1 for single man counter comes to an 8. Therefore, my commander is in command. I will mark him and then carry on applying the results. As you can see here, I placed an in-command marker above the 10-3. I've also placed one above the 10-2, and I will explain why. If a leader is in command, and if there is another leader who is less than his command rating, less than or equal to his command rating, he is also in command. If that guy is within 2 hexes, and within line of sight. These guys are off board, so it is assumed that they are in line of sight of each other. So the 10-3 passes his command onto the 10-2, and he is also marked as in command. Point to note, only leaders are marked as in command. 2 hexes over, we have a half squad 247. He does not need to roll, and he is free to move. If I wish, I can move him now, or I can carry on rolling. I do wish to move him now. I will wait for that and first see if the 248 can also move. I will check him now. I rolled a 10. That means he has failed his command rating attempt. That means the 248 has panicked. I will mark him as such now. In summary, the 10-3 rolled successfully to be in command and is able to pass orders on to the 10-2, who then carries on down to 247. The 247 has no leadership abilities and cannot pass this on to the 248. The 248 checked himself and he failed. It is panicked. It is exactly the same as if he were TI. He cannot move. So this portion of the movement phase is done and I'm going to carry on moving now. I look forward and I see a suspect counter a few hexes away. My cunning plan is to try to activate him by moving up the 247 much the same way that we try to expose concealed counters from the enemy when we're playing a face-to-face. I will move him now. The 247 half squad has moved to within 2 hexes and in the line of sight of the suspect counter at Charlie Charlie 6. What you have to do when you do that, when you move into a line of sight of any suspect counter, is to consider what would a potential IFT DRM be. In this case, any shot coming out of Charlie Charlie 6, ignoring any leadership, be +1 for the hedge, -1 for non-assault movement, would be a net result of 0. I will now consult the Russian chart to see if this is a potential role to activate that suspect counter. Checking the Russian generation table activation check, and remembering that the activation number is 3 for this mission, as we rolled for it last video, we can see here by going down to row C, friendly, that's me, infantry unit is in line of sight within 4 hexes with a final IFT DRM of less than or equal to 0. I'm 2 hexes away with a DRM of 0. We have to roll to see if that unit activates. Activation rolls are a single die. In this case, I rolled a 1. That means the unit will activate. I will now consult the various charts to see what kind of enemy unit will appear in there. I come down to the basic tables and go to chart A1. I remember for the scenario special rule, there is a +2 DRM to any roll in this table. I will now roll now and apply the results. Rolling for activation, I rolled the dice and I've got a 6. Apply the DRM of 2 and I get to a net 8. Let's see what the chart says. On the chart for an 8, it has half squad, but we'll note that it has a superscript of 3. So we consult over to the right-hand side. Squad, if enemy nationality, may not deploy. Russians may not deploy, so we've activated 1 enemy squad in that hex. Let's go to the Russian charts and see which squad we activate. We're now on the Russian tables. Squad, Arm Romeo 2. We have a number of DRMs to the right, and we'll simply roll 2 dice. The year is 1939 to 41, so it's a +2 DRM. I will now roll and apply the results. Today is not my lucky day. I rolled a natural 2, net 4. I will see what the 4 says and apply the results. Net 4 is a 458. So a 458 will be placed in that hex, replacing the suspect counter. I will do that now. The 458 has been activated. If a unit activates due to an enemy unit moving into its line of sight, that unit must fire. Basically, what's happening is, yes, there's a real unit there. Yes, he sees you, and you know this because he's shooting at you. We know at that range, it's a firepower of 4, and we know the DRM is 0. I will now roll and apply the results normally. I rolled the dice, got an 8, no effects, no cowering, therefore there's no effect, and residual firepower of 1 in that hex. I will apply the results now. The results have been applied. The enemy has fired on me to no effect, and I'm basically stuck in that hex. Well, unless I go late CX or start moving. But essentially, that's it. However, he's already only marked with first fire. The point is that the enemy unit, the Russian in this case, will be forced to fire, if possible to fire, according to the rules. We know that any fire would be subsequent first fire, would have to be the closest enemy unit, and, that's about it. So if we get guys running around at range of 3, he will be unable to fire. However, if they get within range 2, then he will be forced to fire. I want to draw his fire off, so I'm going to late CX my half squad and see what kind of fire I can draw from him. I will do this now. I declared a late double time. The unit moved 1 movement factor in the line of sight of the unit at CC7, and this will trigger him to fire at him. He is the closest enemy unit. He is within normal range, so therefore he must fire. We know he's already fired once, so his firepower is 2 with a net DRM of 0. I will now roll and apply the results. It appears the Russian's marksmanship is not all that it's cracked up to be. I rolled a 9. No effect. I will now apply the results. My half squad has successfully drawn that enemy to conduct or commit to final fire. That unit will not fire again unless presented with an opportunity to commit or to conduct final protective fire, which the enemy must do. I have another half squad here ready to bring on. He will declare double time and try to force that enemy unit to fire upon him in final protective fire. I will do so now. The half squad declared double time, expended a total of 5 movement factors, and is moved adjacent to the squad. That squad is now mandated to fire at final protective fire. He's already fired, so his firepower is halved. It's double for point blank for a net firepower of 4 with a DRM of -2. And this firepower, or this fire attack, will also be a normal morale check on that squad, just as per a regular game. I will now roll and apply the results.
Bad news for the Russians. They rolled for a casualty morale check. With his ELR being so low, he has not only ELR'd, but he has also casually reduced and broken. I will apply the results now.
Net result was no effect on the half squad. The half squad that fired out of there has broken, or correction, the squad that was in there broke, casually reduced, and is now DM. So, things are looking good for the Germans, and the Russians seem to be in dire straits. Now let's sum up.
In summary, just remember some of the differences in Solitaire ASL. Remember that your wind change die roll will double for a random event generator. When you're rolling for yourself, you can generate a random event for yourself. When you roll for the enemy's wind change die roll, you could consult an enemy random event. Also remember, before moving, or correction, before conducting any activity outside of rally phase or route phase, units will have to check for command. And finally, when activating, remember that enemy units, when they activate due to enemy movement or your movement, they must fire. And also remember that it is not optional for them to choose not to fire in subsequent first fire when they're able to. Finally, they must fire final protective fire. Okay, that concludes this video. I hope you have picked up a little bit, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about some of the what-ifs, the random events that happen when you're just simply rolling for activation and so forth, especially when it comes to enemy and how they panic. Thank you for watching, and if you like this video, please give me a thumbs up and consider subscribing. Talk to you later.